Welcome back everyone to History with Hilbert, and today I'm going to be looking at a country called But Belgia isn't the only name that the inhabitants have for their country. There's also Belgique and Belgien. Now, recently, Belgium's been having some issues, especially in 2007 to 2011, when there was a crisis and it seemed inevitable that Belgium would rupture and break into several pieces. And it's likely that this might actually still happen at some point in the future if things don't change. Of course, a lot of this has to do with language. Now, in this video, I'd like to look at why this has occurred. Why is Belgium so divided? To answer this question, we have to go way back to a time when there was no Belgium at all, and it belonged to the Holy Roman Empire and some parts of it to France. Now, this is very important because obviously modern day Belgium used to be part of both of these, and this is where some of the problem comes from. Now, this wasn't just a political barrier between the states that made up the Holy Roman Empire and the Kingdom of France. It was also a linguistic barrier between the Germanic and the Romance languages. So this is something which is very important and will be for the future of Belgium and the divide between the two. Now, obviously, the Romance languages were the ones who were slightly more aggressive in this case. Parts of northern France used to speak Flemish, so Dunkirk, for example, is actually its real name is Duinkerken, which is a Germanic name. But the Romance languages on the north coast have pushed up more, and this is the case with Belgium as well. Now, a lot of the time, the lords and magnates who were controlling some of the duchies that made up modern-day Belgium back in the Middle Ages didn't actually speak the same language as the people they were ruling over, which led to an awful lot of confusion, and certainly hasn't helped the modern-day situation because of this historic difference between the nobility and the lower classes of the country. Now, of course, at the time, it was mixed into lots of different duchies inside both the Holy Roman Empire and France, and this will become important later as well. And it seemed this was the way that it was always going to be, until 1566 rolled along and brought with it a certain man.
Ik ben Willem de Zwijger, dat is weliswaar een geuzennaam. Fok je met me volk, breek ik binnen door je keukenraam en neuk je moeder, snuif poeder, neem haar op vakantie. Katholiek of protestant, ze buigen voor mijn tolerantie.
With the misplacement of Spanish General Alva's eyepiece in 1572, the states that would become the Netherlands became independent from Spain. Unofficially at least, and they signed the Treaty of Utrecht, and this was a treaty which said that they would help each other against the Spanish. However, they weren't able to liberate all the countries, or all the provinces rather, that had signed the Treaty of Utrecht, because in opposition to this was the Treaty of Utrecht, which was mostly the French-speaking southern part of the southern Netherlands, which they were unable to liberate, as well as the northern part of the southern Netherlands, which was Flemish or Dutch-speaking, which also wanted to be a part of the independent Dutch Republic because the Spanish were too strong in these areas, and this led to some issues. To understand the next part of the story, we have to skip forwards to 1815, when Napoleon was finally defeated at Waterloo, or Waterloo, which was itself in Flanders in what is now Belgium. And we have to take a look at the Kingdom of the Netherlands, as the Southern Netherlands became part of the Kingdom of the Netherlands at this time. So here we have the Flemish or the Dutch names for the provinces: West-Vlaanderen, Oost-Vlaanderen, Noord-Brabant, Antwerpen, Zuid-Brabant, Henegouwen, Namen, Limburg, Luik, Luxembourg, and in French they have different names, which are Flandre Occidentale, Flandre Orientale, Brabant du Nord, Anvers, Brabant du Sud, Hainaut, Namur, Lambourg, Liège, and Luxembourg. And in English we know them as West Flanders, East Flanders, North Brabant, Antwerp or Antwerp, South Brabant, Hainaut or Hainaut, I don't know, Namur, Limburg, Liège, and Luxembourg. Now, of course, it's a very important date is 1830, and 1830 is the date of the Belgian Revolution, where the people of Belgium, or more specifically and very strongly actually, the French-speaking people of Belgium, and not necessarily the Flemish, who were aided by the French, declared independence from the Netherlands. Now, this was caused by a number of reasons. One was indeed that there were economic problems in the south of the Netherlands, in the area that would become Belgium. Also linguistic issues, that these people felt more aligned with the French than with the Dutch because they spoke a different language. But anyway, after the Belgian Revolution and after the Dutch tried to reclaim Belgium, but the other European powers stepped in because they'd rather have a buffer state, the Belgian Revolution succeeded and Belgium became its own country. However, they also managed to take with them the northern provinces, the ones that might not necessarily have wanted to belong to a new and independent country. Now, we need to take another look at these states because this is really the crux of where things became difficult with the linguistic divide. Now, we have to take a look at, obviously, where they were speaking the different languages. And the different languages, a quick note about those, is that sometimes they are called Flemish. There is a language which is called West Flams or West Flemish. It's debatable whether it's a language or a dialect again. But essentially, Flemish is pretty much the same as Dutch. There are differences, don't get me wrong, but it is pretty much the same as Dutch. I can understand the vast majority of Flemish. A similar thing with Walloon and French, although there is slightly more of a difference there, I believe, and Walloon is treated as a regional language. But for the purposes of this video, I'm going to keep it nice and simple. I'll look into this in more detail later on. But essentially, these are the provinces which were speaking West Flemish or Flemish and Dutch. And these are the ones speaking Walloon and French. And actually, then you have Luxembourg, which is the odd one out, because in Luxembourg, they were speaking German, French and Luxembourgish, which is its own language at the time. And the Prussians actually contested the Dutch for control over Luxembourg at this time. And Luxembourg in 1839, which is sort of the end of the Belgian Revolution crisis, they became independent and fully recognized as independent thanks to the Treaty of London, which sorted out the entire Belgian secession deal which had gone on. So now to move forward, we need to take a look at actually Belgium, because obviously now Belgium is its own country. Now we see that one part is a lot richer than the other, and that part would be the southern part of Belgium, with the aforementioned French-speaking part of Belgium called Wallonia. And they were a lot more successful, at least initially, because they had all the industry in the south. As well, the French speakers were the most rich and they were also the most powerful people in the country. And even in Flanders, the richer people weren't the Dutch or Flemish speakers, they were the French speakers. And obviously this created a lot of problems and socio-linguistic divide inside the country itself. Now this really came to a head in the First World War. Obviously Belgium was invaded and the majority of the country was taken over by the German army in the First World War. And there were a lot of stories of soldiers, Flemish soldiers, and that the commanders refused to give commands or were unable to give commands in Flemish, and so they had no idea what was going on, and therefore a lot of them died. Now, whether this actually happened isn't known for certain, but we are sure that Flemish and Dutch speakers were looked down upon by the French. It wasn't an official language, and they didn't have as many rights as the French speakers in the south of the country. Now, this is especially true before 1945, when we see that the southern part, the Walloons, they had a much better economy because it was industrial, whereas the north was agricultural and didn't really advance very much. However, after the Second World War, these places flipped around, because obviously Belgium had been hit by the two world wars, and a lot of the rebuilding that went on happened in Flanders. A lot of American investment went to Flanders, and Flanders suddenly started to rise in the tech industries and other industries and became the richer part, while the South stagnated economically. Now, we see this even today in unemployment figures, where the unemployment in Wallonia is over half as much as in Flanders, and as well in the types of industries. Now, in the north, there's a lot of tech-based industries, a lot of what they call sunrise industries, as in industries that are just starting up and are expected to grow exponentially, so things like tech and services. Whereas in the south, in Wallonia, they had a lot of steel production, coal mining, that kind of thing. And these obviously are industries that are really shrinking, as they have done all over Europe in the last half century. So you see the big difference there, that the economic downturn for the south and the economic growth in the north are likely to continue, again showing that Belgium is divided on this. Now, if we look at politics as well, it's clear. Now, politics started obviously as soon as Belgium became independent. They do have a king who was a German. Leopold was the first king of Belgium. I believe he was also of the Saxe-Coburg family, so making him a relation to the current monarchs of Great Britain. But that's by the by. However, the politics in Belgium, it was a constitutional monarchy. And you see, essentially, that you have the kind of the Liberal Party on who are more progressive in nature, and also the more conservative Catholic Party. These were the initial two parties in Belgium, and then as the 19th century wore on, towards the end of the 19th century, you obviously get the socialist parties as well, which were then looking out for the working man. Now, politics in Belgium obviously froze during the occupation in the Second World War, which I believe was from 1940 up until 1945 or late 1944 probably in Belgium. And obviously politics froze then, but after the war we see a huge shift in policy in Belgium. And we see that all the traditional parties, they split, and by the 1970s they've all split into linguistic parties on both the left, the centre and the right. That each party has a Flemish party, which represents pretty much the same thing as a French or Wallon speaking party on the other side, and that this divide was huge. Now, it was only in 1969 that a Flemish or a Dutch version of the Belgian constitution was actually written, which is amazing considering the amount of Dutch and Flemish speakers in the country. So it really goes to show how long it took for this linguistic equality, if you will, to be reached in Belgium. Now, the Belgian government today tries to split itself equally 50-50 Flemish and French-speaking, as well as some German-speaking, although that's really a minority, a much smaller group that speak German in the very east of the country. And as well, they have split the country into various speaking communities, so obviously the Flemish-speaking community in the north, the French-speaking community in the south, the two German-speaking communities in the east, and Brussels, which is the capital, which is really a big issue, and I'll get onto that a bit later. That is actually a mixed zone of mostly French speakers with a few or a large minority of Flemish speakers, and each of these have their own government, which really does not help the situation. And they have become more and more autonomous, even though the French-speaking community does not want more autonomy for any groups. The Flemish-speaking community really does want more autonomy. So you can see that, again, the country is pulling in different directions. Now, what the solution of this will be, most people have thought that if there was going to be a split, it would be a split of Flanders and Wallonia into two different countries. But we might actually see something like a North Belgium and perhaps a South Belgium on the other side that sort of stay in a federation or some kind of connection between the two. Of course, the issue is what happens to Brussels. Now, maybe the logical point of view from a geographic idea would be that Brussels would join onto an independent Flanders, as this geographically makes sense. But of course, linguistically and culturally, the people are French, so it would make more sense in the kind of cultural idea to have Brussels join the south of Belgium, the French-speaking part of Belgium, but then it would be in its own little enclave inside another country. Now, it gets even more complicated when you add in the German states. What would happen to them? Would they become an independent state, or would they become part of the southern part of Belgium, of Wallonia into the French-speaking part, or would they form part of a slightly grosser Deutschland? Who knows what would happen if Belgium does indeed split in half? And there are even people who want Belgium or their respective part of Belgium to join onto another country, and it exists for both groups. Now, for the French speakers, there is this ideology called ratchetism, which is essentially that they would like to join onto France as essentially a northern province. They've obviously, they share the language in common and a lot of culture. French, Belgian French isn't very, very different to French French. They can easily understand each other. Now, Wallon is a little bit more difficult, but culturally they are fairly similar, obviously both Catholic, that kind of thing. And for the Flemish, there is also a kind of movement. It doesn't really have a name. name. The ratchetist flag is actually an actual thing on the left-hand side, although I designed the other flag myself because it's there isn't an official flag for the Flemish who want to join onto the Netherlands. But there is this idea of Great Netherlandism, which is essentially the Dutch-speaking parts of Northern Europe joining the Netherlands. And this has been proposed as a solution, that they would join the Netherlands. Obviously, culturally and linguistically, they are very much related. And actually, some of the provinces, which I showed on the map previously, Noord-Brabant, for example, when they split, they actually split. So you have a Brabant in both the Netherlands and Belgium, and you have a province called Limburg in both the Netherlands and Belgium. So the border is really a political one rather than a cultural or linguistic one on the Dutch side. However, Belgium, which doesn't have a border in the middle, is not a kind of continuum of culture and language. There is a clear dividing line there, which is very interesting. So thank you very much for watching. This has been my video on the problems in Belgium, the linguistic divide. I really hope you have enjoyed this and that I've not rambled on too much and that there's not been too many flags and crazy theories at the end. But if you did enjoy this, then I might put up a poll and see what kind of follow-up video you would like from this, whether it's about the sort of the Flemish and Walloon languages, how different they are, maybe about the Belgian flag and the Dutch flag, or perhaps some scenarios that could happen for how Belgium might fall apart. Now, I'd just like to say that I'm not advocating for Belgium to fall apart or for the Netherlands to invade Belgium or anything like that. I'm just saying it's a possibility that might happen, which I hope I have proved in this video because of all the differences between the country. Although, of course, if Belgium's future is that Belgium stays together and that there is more unity between the two groups, then great, that's completely fine. So again, thanks very much for watching. I'm History with Hilbert. If you have enjoyed this, please give me a thumbs up. If you'd like to know anything more or share any information, respectfully though, in the comments, then feel free to do so. And if you're new and want to see more, why not check out some of my other videos in the description as well as some others and hit that subscribble button. So thank you very much. I'm History with Hilbert, and I will see you all again.